something fishy was happening. It was DFIR time. We started looking at the container logs.
It's called reversal. Container escape or lateral movement.
Hi, I'm here with Miguel.
Hi.
A security expert, and we are going to watch a video about digital forensics.
All right, let's go.
It was a rainy night, as it always happens. We suddenly got paged by our trusty Falco sidekick. Something fishy was happening in an application server container.
Okay, this is normal. You are on a call and you receive an alert from your tool and you need to know what happened or where.
Okay, and what is that tool that sends the alert?
This one is Falco Sidekick. Okay. It's an interface for Falco, that is a runtime security tool, and it can integrate alerts from with other systems like Slack or...
Mm-hmm. Oh, so you get the notification of the alerts.
Yeah, exactly. Right.
There was no time to waste. It was DFIR time.
So, Miguel, what is DFIR?
DFIR means Digital Forensic and Incident Response. It's like a detective work for a cybersecurity attack.
Okay, so it's like a CSI TV series, but instead of a murderer, we are trying to catch a cyber attacker?
Yeah, something similar. You need to gather all the information you can, you need to understand what happened, and finally, you need to catch the attacker.
Nice.
The alert was clear. Someone was downloading shady files on one container.
Okay, you see the curl command?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, this is very common. When an attacker gets access to your vulnerable container, they try to download more files or binaries or malware, for example, for crypto mining.
Mm-hmm. So how would you stop this type of attack?
Yeah, one option would be use minimal image or distroless, because this kind of tools like curl is not installed in the container.
Oh. Makes sense.
But this is not the real question, because this is the end of the story and we need to know what happened inside your container, because we are already compromised.
The target apparently was an application server pod in one of our Kubernetes clusters. The on-call team was quick in their initial response. They applied a deny all network policy to the pod, preventing any further traffic.
And what are they doing here? Why are they adding a label to the pod?
Well, they are marking the pod as compromised with the label, and it's faster if you need to stop all the network connection for the pod, and also you want to reuse this policy, it's very easy to label again.
Oh, I see. So they can use that policy to stop all the connections to the pod that have that label.
Yeah, that's the idea, because it's important to not allow the attacker to get access again to the compromised container.
Hmm, nice.
Floodgates closed. As a further precaution, the node hosting the pod was also cordoned. This prevented new pods on the cluster from being executed on that node.
So, Miguel, they have stopped the network connection with the network policy, but why cordoning the whole node?
Well, as we can see in the alert, the attacker tried to download more things, and we don't know if he's able to perform some techniques like container escape or lateral movement that control the entire node. For that, it's important to prevent.
Oh, makes sense.
The next step was taking a snapshot of all the volumes attached to the virtual machine executing the pod. This created a point-in-time photograph of all the files on the disk.
Okay, this is the snapshot process. It's very important to preserve the files because you don't know if the attacker tried to remove files to hide their activity. Mm-hmm. And also, you can use this snapshot for a deeper analysis in the future.
Oh, so that's for the forensic part, analyzing what happened.
Exactly.
I see.
From the look of things, we didn't need to go any further. With the incident contained and the evidence gathered, I could finally start the forensic investigation. Now it was time to answer the questions that have been buzzing in my head all along. what really happened? And what was the real impact? We started looking at the container logs. Usually, we would have searched for them in our SIM tool, but from the alert, we knew where to look.
So, what is a SIM tool?
It's a tool that allows you to gather all the information, logs, events, in a single place, and you can query or search information like evidence.
Mm-hmm. So, that's faster having everything together without having to look at all the places around.
Yeah, and also you can reconstruct the attacker path when you receive the alert.
Nice.
The logs confirmed there was a new application deployed in our Tomcat.
Okay, see these logs? Mm-hmm. Well, it's very suspicious to deploy an application inside a container.
But why? It's a Tomcat, it's an application server. It's normal to deploy application.
Yeah, but not inside a container. If you want to deploy applications, you need to deploy the entire Tomcat with the new application, not go inside the container and deploy application.
Oh, yeah, so that's strange.
It was showtime. We needed to check what files were changed from the original container image. With some container foo, we were able to get the container snapshot ID and compare it with the base image. This gave us an archive with all the changed files. We got our smoking gun and other evidence of the tampering.
Okay, Miguel, walk me through this. I see they are listing the containers, they are listing the snapshot, but what is that diff thing?
They are comparing the container image from the registry and the container snapshot with the current state of the container. And with this diff tool, we are comparing the files that are changed to understand the attacker activity.
Okay, so they get the changed files, and I guess they are searching for that RSH string they found earlier in the logs?
Yeah, and now they are saving these files in an archive.
Okay. Oh, so they can check it later like the snapshot they did before.
Exactly.
We let out a collective sigh of relief. It seems we caught the mischief in time, before he could move laterally through our cluster and other parts of our infrastructure. We also saved a copy of the compromised container image. It will make a good test case for future analysis.
So, why are they saving the whole container image? Didn't they just get the archive with the changed files?
Well, with this, we can deploy again the exact image. We can reproduce the security issue, and also we can audit the container with security tools to find some vulnerabilities, or even we can match if this is the exactly image that we deploy in the past.
Okay, but why checking if that is the right image? Isn't that defined in the manifest?
Well, if you check the tag here, it's the latest, and this is not a good practice. It's better to use fixed version because it's possible to tamper this version and be vulnerable with the container.
Oh, makes sense.
It was time to understand what really happened. We analyzed offline the files downloaded on the container.
Okay, see here? Mm-hmm. They mount a volume creating from the snapshot we took before in a different machine.
But isn't that dangerous? I mean, we stopped the things on one machine and now we take the exact same machine and put it in another place?
Well, this kind of analysis is done in a forensic machine. Mm-hmm. And this machine is isolated for the other network and also is not allowed to connect from external activity, and only the forensic analyst is able to connect with this machine.
What are they doing with this tool?
They are using Container Explorer. It's a tool that analyzes the disk, and we can show the containers running inside. And here we saw the Tomcat application that we are looking for.
Nice.
Well, now they are mounting that contain file system to explore what files are creating or modifying.
Oh, they are doing like this? So they are not executing the container? So.
Yeah, exactly. They try to find some weird files or things inside the Tomcat path. And as you can see, the attacker deployed the Tomcat and we have this string name, shell.jsp.
Oh, it's Java stuff, Java server pages.
Yeah, basically it's Java embedded in a web page. And if we go inside the code, we can see a socket that have an address and a port and execute whatever comes through the connection.
Oh, it's like having a terminal.
Exactly, like that, but it's called reversal because the connection starts from the container, not from the attacker.
Oh, it's from the server to the client.
Yeah, that's the idea.
I see.
What happened was, a wrong Tomcat version was deployed with a manager application exposed to the internet and a weak password. Someone found that endpoint and brute forced the password. They were able to upload a web application that gave them a reverse shell with which they were trying to download other stuff. And that's where we caught them and stopped them.
Okay, see here? Let's back a bit. Here, the attacker listening that port to the container connection. Mm-hmm. And as we can see, the attackers deployed this malicious application with this string code, and when the attacker visits the page, we have the connection established.
Oh, so right now, everything that the attacker enters in his netcat session is executing in the container.
Exactly, it's a shell. Oh. It's important to notice that the user is root. This is high privileged user. And with this, the attacker is able to perform some techniques like container escape or lateral movement to control the entire node.
So that's why it was important to stop all the connections and also cordon the node.
Exactly. And another thing to mention here is an skilled attacker is usually try to get more privilege inside a vulnerable application and use techniques like lateral movement or persistence. And as we can see in the alert, when try to download more files inside the container.
Okay, so now he's trying to open other backdoors to gain access in case they close one.
Yeah. Exactly. And now it's important to make sure that what is the vulnerability they exploit because we don't like to repeat this in the future.
That meant we had to fix the deploy process to prevent a similar error from happening. And also, our Falco rules for our internet exposed containers needed to be tuned a bit.
So what do they mean here about fixing the deploy process?
Well, in this case, it appears that the Tomcat container is deployed and exposed the Tomcat manager, and this is a bad practice.
And that's where the attacker came in, right?
Exactly. You need to implement some fix or policies to prevent this behavioral because you don't want to repeat this in the future.
And that's what they mean when they say shift left security?
Exactly. You need to put more efforts in the prevent step because otherwise in here we have the Falco rule to detect in the last step or last layer of security, but sometimes it's better to prevent more than detect.
And speaking about detection, what they were saying something about tuning their Falco rules?
Well, as we can see in the video, in the first part, we receive an alert from the Falco sidekick, but the command is the curl and that downloads some binaries or malware. This is the final step of the attack. We need to improve the rules to detect the shell span in the container, or maybe this bad application deploy in the cluster, some kind of things to get more faster in the detection part.
Yeah, and it's probably easier to prevent those things.
Exactly.
That was honest detective work. The rain had stopped, the sun was just rising, and I had a hot coffee waiting for me. Time to write the incident report. Now, did I tell you about that time when...
Nice video. What do you think about it?
Well, I like it a lot. It's fiction, but very close to reality.
Well, it was nice seeing the attacker point of view, but also the forensic part with all the tools analyzing the containers. But what about the incident report?
Well, the incident report, there will be some very important parts like the attacker techniques or the evidence, the response we do when this incident appear. And also it's important to give this information for other teams like the third research with the IP we detect in the code.
Oh, so they can prevent this type of attacks in the future.
Exactly. And also we need to learn from this incident to don't repeat it in the future and configure very well our application, don't run the container as root or this security best practice.
So DFIR is not only incident response, but it's also what comes later. So analyzing what happened, understanding what happened, understanding what are the weak points of our infrastructure, learning from that and all the changes in the processes, like applying policies to the deploys and tuning the file rules, everything.
Yeah, it's a never-ending improvement process.
Nice. So thank you, Miguel.
Thank you.
And thank you for watching this video. If you learned something new, let us know in the comments. And if you like this video, give us a like and subscribe to our channel. We have a lot more content coming. See ya.
Bye.